Good morning, everyone. My name is Mackenzie Knight-Fochs, and I'm the Education Programs Manager here at the Scott Arboretum of Swarthmore College. Today, we are going to be exploring the evergreens of the Arboretum's collection. Now, when I mention evergreens, you're probably thinking of a pine tree or perhaps the Christmas tree that's in your house right now, and you would be correct. But there's much more to the world of evergreens than just those two options, and we will explore those today. So what is an evergreen? Well, there are many different kinds, and essentially an evergreen just doesn't lose its leaves all at once like our typical deciduous trees, such as a maple or an oak. So let's look at some examples here. On this bench, I have brought together several examples. Our first example is this white pine, and this is not the cone that goes with that white pine, but it is a needled evergreen, and it might be what you expect. So you see the needles, you see a cone. And then moving next to this, we have a yew. So these needles are slightly different looking. They're a little bit flatter. And in fact, yews create something called an aril, that is a red berry looking thing, but it is still in the conifer family. Next to it, it is a cherry laurel. And this keeps its leaves all year round, but is in fact a broadleaf. And that's a very common landscape plant. You often see it in your borders or landscape plantings around your house. Next to the cherry laurel is our holly, which is another classic from the holidays. And, you know, the pokey leaves, and we got our red berries there. So that's different from the cones. So these are two temperate broadleaf evergreens. So across these four examples of evergreens, we've got very clearly our needled evergreens and that are also conifers, and then our broadleaf evergreens, because the leaves on them are flat. And then to throw a little bit of a curveball towards you, I have this tropical cycad, which is also an evergreen. It loses its fronds throughout the year as well, but it occurs in tropical climates doesn't experience a winter per se. So as you can see, there's quite a lot of evergreen types. And here we have our first pine of the day. It is Pinus bungeana, or the lacebark pine. This is a particularly gorgeous specimen. I don't know how tall this one is, but they can reach heights of 30 to 50 feet tall and get a spread of 20 to 35 feet tall. So as you see, we've got our needles, our pine needles, the typical, which provides, you know, year-round interest. But the real like piece de resistance on this tree is the bark. It looks very beautiful. It is kind of a camouflage pattern. It's exfoliating and just is a real stunning piece in the landscape. So you do, when planting this and, you know, growing it over time, want to consider this and how you prune the tree so you can really see and enjoy this interesting piece of winter interest. And honestly, it looks like this all year round, but you really appreciate it when there's not much else to look at in the garden. And now we have Osmanthus X fortunii, Fortune's Osmanthus. And initially looking at it, you might think this is a holly, but it's not. It is an Osmanthus. The leaves that you can see right now are actually the juvenile form of the leaves. So they've got those serrated edges with the points. As they become more mature, as you can see going up the plant, they lose that serration and those points and become smoothed edge. Now, one of the highlights of this being in front of the Arboretum office door is the fact that their fragrance of the small flowers that you can't see anymore, but because they're done blooming, but they smell amazing in, you know, late fall, early winter time, around November for us. So you walk by on especially a warmer day and it's just like, what is that smell? And turns out it's this Osmanthus. As you can see, it does get about 15 to 20 feet tall, but you can use it as a dense hedge and providing that, you know, evergreen look so you can't see your neighbors or whoever across from you. And it is hardy to zone 7, so us, and they do really well for us. And it's also a really nice holiday green because you can do a little bit of pruning and you can pretend it's holly. Other people won't know. And now we have a bit of a surprise for you. Looking at this tree above, you may think, oh yeah, that's just another broadleaf evergreen, no big deal. In fact, it's an oak tree. Surprise! Quercus myrcinifolia, which is the Chinese evergreen oak, has not what you typically expect to be oak leaves. So they are that long lanceolate type leaf with a little bit of serration. There are no multiple lobes like our typical white or red oak here in North America. So when I was an intern and I saw this tree back in 2012, 2013, I was like, that's not an oak tree. It doesn't look like a typical oak tree, but surprise, it is. It's actually got very interesting different kinds of cups on the acorns, and it can reach 80 feet in height, and it will mature to a compact rounded crown. But as you can see here, it's a little bit more narrow when it's young, and then we can continue to prune it upwards and allow people to get close and realize like what it actually is. It is the most cold hardy of all the Asian evergreen oaks, and it's hardy to at least USDA zone 7, so good for us. And it typically grows in high summer rainfall areas. So here in the Philadelphia area, we get a lot of rainfall, except for, you know, this past summer when it was drought. But that's the best part, is that it has high drought tolerance, and especially notable for us when we have high temperatures in the summertime as well. The next plant that we're going to be looking at is this beautiful Mahonia X Media Buckland is the cultivar, which is a hybrid Mahonia. Now, it's got terrifying looking leaves, which are very prickly, I speak from experience, as well as these really lovely flowers right now, which are unique because there's not a ton of things that are blooming at the beginning of December in the Philadelphia area. The pollinators really love this. In fact, we saw a honeybee on one of these earlier today. And there are some varieties and species of Mahonia that have a really wonderful fragrance, but because this is a hybrid Mahonia, it has lost that fragrance. And this one right now is kind of a smaller plant, but over time it will become filling of this space underneath our yellow wood, and it will get up to 6 to 10 feet tall and wide. And you can do a good job of pruning this. Again, makes an interesting, you know, if you wanted to really go for it, cut flower, as well as greens for your holiday arrangements if you wanted to add some spikiness in addition to your holly. So we have a really lovely alternative to cherry laurel behind me. You can see it's blooming right now. Again, not many things do bloom at this time of year, but the more you go around the arboretum, the more you find things that are blooming. This is a camellia, and it's one of the various varieties we've been trialing here at the arboretum since 2011. So camellias are enjoying a resurgence in the past several years because of the increased cold hardiness, thanks to some of the breeding efforts from Dr. Clifford Parks of Camellia Forest Nursery and Dr. Ackerman, who is formerly of the USDA. In fact, the one behind me is one of the Ackerman hybrids and from one of the seedlings here. So this one's a nice pink one that has kind of that single round of flowers. One of the keys to the camellias being frost tolerant and cold hardy is the fact that they can handle those cold temperatures. And the idea is to have them not produce buds that are opening all at once. So you can see there are some buds that are just starting. There are some flowers that clearly got hit by some frost, and kind of that variation then, because if you lose them to cold temperatures, it's not such a problem for the plant itself to reproduce. And here on Chester Road, at the beginning of our camellia collection, I'm actually standing next to a really interesting specimen of holly. And this is Ilex X attenuata Longwood Gold. As the name indicates, it's got gold berries, yellow berries, which is interesting and unique for a holly. We have a couple yellow berried cultivars down here. But what's interesting about this is that it has been nominated by the Holly Society of America as the Holly of the Year for 2022. As the name suggests, this female holly is from Longwood Gardens, which is only a few miles down the road from us in southeastern Pennsylvania, and it bears these lovely crops of yellow fruit. This is a younger planting, another younger specimen, so it's not quite as tall and as large and as fruit-filled as perhaps it will get as it continues to grow, but it is really nice, and I particularly enjoy it and really love it. So now here at the Scott Arboretum, we love us some camellias. And right here is a very lovely specimen of Camellia Springs Promise. And as the name indicates, it shouldn't be blooming right now. We had a bout of some pretty cold weather, so that seems to be just enough cold weather to make this camellia believe that it was time to start blooming. These are really lovely plants that grow best in the dappled shade, so you can see it's underneath Suga canadensis over here, and then we've got a variety of other hollies and types of conifers that are growing to provide that nice dappled shade. Another really great thing about camellias are they are generally deer resistant, so think about that if you have a lot of deer in your yard. for whatever reason, they're not quite as appetizing. Not to say that they won't be eaten at all. This specimen is Camellia Winter's Interlude. So this camellia is one of the winter series hybrids that are fall blooming camellias, so it is supposed to be blooming right now, that provide that really lovely winter fall interest. And this was from Dr. Ackerman that I mentioned earlier, and they were developed for that cold hardiness after a series of cold winters nearly destroyed the collections of Camellia japonica and Camellia sasanqua at the U.S. National Arboretum. So he chose to hybridize with Camellia oleifera because it didn't have any of that winter injury. He made some interspecific crosses, and those resulting hybrids were released in 1991, and those hybrids showed little to no winter injury as far north as where we are, USDA Zone 6, or as cold as 10 below Fahrenheit in sheltered locations. So again, we started experimenting with planting camellias here almost a decade ago now, and they are doing really nicely for us. But this specimen is Picea orientalis, the oriental spruce. This is a conifer tree. Evergreen, and its habit, as you can see, is fairly upright, but it's densely branched. And one of the highlights is the fact that it's got these really dark green needles. One of the key features of this plant that I really enjoy are the very upward ends on the branches that kind of makes it look like it's a ski slope that you're going to go jump off of. Another piece that you can see on the other side of the tree is its bark. It's got really nice kind of squarish plating, scaling bark here, and it's very nice. And you can also see, you can cut and prune it so you see that bark a little bit more nicely in the landscape. Another of the winter series hybrid is this winter snowman. So these winter series hybrids, again, were selected for their particular cold hardiness. And unlike the other winter's interlude that we were looking at earlier, this one is white. So we have kind of a white and pink variation in flowers, and they do really nicely here. This is Ilex opaca yellow fruit. That yellow fruit is not a cultivar. It's just a yellow fruited choice of the American holly, which is this plant. Usually you'll see this with red berries. One of the key things to remember about hollies is that they are dioecious. So you've got plants that have male flowers and plants that have female flowers. And only the plants that have the female flowers are the ones that bear the fruit. So important to keep this in mind, that you consider the pollinator, that there is another male specimen of another American holly within 30 to 40 feet of your hollies that you're planting in your yard. And to cap off our winter series of camellia, we have Winter's Joy right here, this pink kind of almost double sort of petaled camellia. And right next to it is Camellia Winter's Flurry. And this one, again, is almost that double flowered, but it's white. So really lovely specimens of camellia that you should definitely consider for your yard if you've got some dappled shade on a nice, well-draining acidic soil. And one last look at another yellow-fruited holly is Ilex opaca Boyce Thompson Xanthocarpa, which is another yellow-fruited American holly coming from the Boyce Thompson Arboretum, for which it is named. And as you can see, the berries are a little bit different than some of the other yellow-fruited ones, but they just look very nice. And I enjoy this specimen, and I love that it's just amongst the camellias. You've got your yellow, you've got your white, and you've got your pink all together. Here we are in the Pinetum at the Scott Arboretum. In the background, you can see our newest building on campus, the dining center. When this part of the building, it's actually an addition to the original dining area, Sharples, when it was being ideated, we realized it would have an impact to our Pinetum collection. However, that allowed us to evolve the collection in fun ways. So here, in all of our collection areas, we've got these really nice signs, and we do have a nice Pinetum brochure that you should definitely pick up and check out when you are here on campus. So in the Pinetum, we've got a variety of different types of cone-bearing plants, because that's what a Pinetum is. It is a collection of cone-bearing plants. So this one here is very special. It is Pinus densiflora Burke's Red Variegated. It's a Japanese red pine. So it is a cultivar of the Pinus densiflora, and it's a form of the dragon's eye type of Japanese red pine. And it's got this striking wide horizontal yellow bands on leaves that you can see here. And that is just really different. And these are visible year-round. It looks like this all the time, but they become a little bit more of obvious in the colder climates and then also as we go into the winter time. So if you look down one of the shoots of the end of the branches, you can kind of see a yellow circle around of each of the buds that as you're looking down. So it's got that interesting variegation, and it does grow a little bit slower because it's a variegated type plant. So because there is more yellow than there is green, the photosynthetic rate is a little bit less. Ultimately, it will get to be about 20 feet high and 15 feet wide. It is hardy to zone 5. And it does require full sun. Again, that is helpful with the photosynthesis because it needs all the sunlight it can get to grow and be strong and healthy. So here in our collection, we've got on the right-hand side, Thuja occidentalis lutea, which is a cultivar of an Eastern arborvitae. And then right next to it to the left is Thuja plicata atrovirens, which is another cultivar of the Western arborvitae. So between these two specimens, you can see differences. The Thuja occidentalis on the right has more of a compact, narrow, upright spacing, and that is because of the cultivar it is. And then the Thuja plicata has a more of a pyramidal form to it. And one of the important things here at the Arboretum is being able to communicate about which trees are more important, because as noted with the dining center, there is always construction happening. So one of the ways that we've been able to do that over the past few years is by developing our heritage tree program, which is a way of us comparing all the trees in our collection against certain parameters and being able to say, these are important specimens that we don't want to lose to construction. And to learn more about that, you can go to our website. And also if you are like, I love trees, you can support us creating an endowment for this particular program. So with the Eastern arborvitae, usually you see these as dense hedge-forming trees. This one, again, they are in the conifer family. They create cones, but they've got a scale-like leaf. And that is different than the typical needled that you were thinking of with the pines. So what is wonderful about these two specimens is you can see the bark on them. So here are the Eastern arborvitae. You can really see the lovely bark structure on it and appreciate that, because usually that is all covered by its foliage. But here you can see how it evolves and grows over time. So it is in the cypress family, and it's just a really nice tree and really wonderful that we have an example like this in our landscape to point to and to show. This one does have a multiple leader situation going on, which is generally not as ideal just for snow load, because they can, if they have not just one straight leader, they will spread out if the snow is too heavy. But obviously this one is old enough and happy enough. So this again is the Western arborvitae, Thuja plicata atrovirens. And this is the heritage tree. You can see on our display labels, we've got a heritage tree logo on there, an icon. And this bark here is a little bit shaggier than our Eastern arborvitae. And the cultivar atrovirens is because it's got dark green foliage. So you can kind of see that in the difference. Again, that's got the scale-like leaves on it, does produce cones, is a conifer as well. Now, the other difference between the Thuja occidentalis and Thuja plicata is that the plicata is more of a pyramidal shape. And you can see it has a very strong central leader to it. And it's just an all-around beautiful specimen. This is a really lovely tree that holds a special place in my heart. It's our Eastern hemlock. It's Tsuga canadensis. And one of the reasons that's so special to me is that there was a grove of these on my great-grandmother's land, and I would walk through the forest with my father, and he would always point them out. And one of the identifying features for the Eastern hemlock are these really adorable cones. And they are just so small and so wee, and they hold on, and I really love them. They also have a very flat, short needle, and so that's another identifying feature. And also on the back of the needle, you can kind of see that white, the white bands, and those are additional identifying features for the Eastern hemlock. One of the unfortunate things is that it is susceptible to a hemlock woolly adelgid. There are treatments for this, but they are facing a little bit of trouble because of that on the Eastern seaboard and kind of throughout the United States. So. Hemlock woolly adelgid looks like type of mealybug on the on these, and they're just like a white fuzzy thing. So again, that can be treated. I don't know if it's particularly inexpensive, but something to think about if you've got a nice specimen. So our next highlight is the Abies Nordmanniana Golden Spreader. This is a cultivar of a Nordman fir, and Nordman firs, the straight species, can get like very, very tall, up to 50 feet tall in cultivation, or up to 200 feet tall in their native range of the Caucasus Mountains. However, these buddies are only gonna get between 2 to 4 feet tall themselves. This is a very sunny addition to your winter garden because that golden color for which it is selected shows up really nicely in the wintertime. And it has a compact bun-like shape, and it is a dwarf cultivar of this variety and this type of fir. So a really fun little buddy for your garden. We're looking at another pine here. This is Pinus flexilis, Vanderwolf's Pyramid, and it is a limber pine, as you might not be surprised to hear. This is a smaller variety, and by variety I mean specimen. It is 20 to 30 feet in height, and then it can go spreading to 10 to 15 feet. So one of the features of this are the really beautiful blue-green leaves, and they kind of twist a little bit. And one of the interesting things about this specimen we're looking at is you can see that evergreens do in fact shed their needles, shed their leaves. So in a little bit further, you can see these brown needles that are gonna be dropping eventually. In amongst this is planted underneath a bald cypress. So there are some nice golden bald cypress needles also hanging out in there, but that's just normal shedding in the leaf. So here we have the monkey puzzle tree, which has a Latin name that is difficult to pronounce, and I'm not gonna get it right, but I pronounce it Araucaria araucana. And this is actually a Chilean native. You find it in the mountains, in the Andes Mountains. So you might be thinking, why is it here in Philadelphia? And the answer is, because we wanna try it. And as you're looking at this, it's just got such a beautiful structure, but also a little bit terrifying with how pokey the leaves are on it. And you can see it's got this really interesting scaled bark with additional leaves along it. So third time is the charm for us with this plant because we've replanted a couple times. And as you can see on my right hand side, there's a tree that looks a little rough, and then there's one that looks less rough, and then there's the one that looks the best. So siting is really important. They like that well-drained soil. Thinking about how evergreens live in areas that the soil nutrients aren't that great, it makes sense that you would want to be in a spot where they can thrive in that type of environment and not have too wet of feet and not have too rich of soil. So another consideration is that I'm looking at the sun right now. So this is a full sun environment. They live in those Andes Mountains. They're getting as much sun as they can, and they are doing better to various degrees based on that. So we're continuing to try these out, but it is kind of pushing maybe a little bit of limits here in the Philadelphia area. Another feature that we have today is the Cunninghamia lanceolata Chazen's Gift, which is the common China fir, a cultivar of that. The common China fir can reach up to heights of 150 feet tall, which this one isn't. So when it's grown in cultivation, it won't reach those heights, 75 feet, but because this is a cultivar, it actually is more compact form, reaching up to 40 feet tall, which is a little more manageable for the homeowner. And one of the highlights is this very spiky, that seems to be a theme with our evergreens lately, types of needles that we have here. So they're not that bad when they are nice and green. However, if you look more closely in, you can see them losing their needles as well. And as they get to be brown, they become a little bit more treacherous. But this is a really nice specimen. This specimen is a Cyadopides verticillata, which is a Japanese umbrella pine. I have known this plant from my original location in Wisconsin, and it was just this small little plant that I learned during my woody plant identification course. This buddy is a little bit bigger, just a little bit. It can reach a height of 30 to 70 feet tall in cultivation, and in its native habitat of Japan, it can be over 100 feet tall. One of the identifying characteristics of this plant are the whorls of leaves, the whorls of needles, which are its leaves, on the plant itself. And then the needles are also actually, they look kind of like rubber. They're not, but they just have that very thick waxy coating. And it's really fun to note that it's just very different than anything you see typically with a type of pine tree. This is not a pine tree. In fact, it is in the Cyadopidaceae family, and it is the only plant that is in that plant family. So it's very unique and very special, and we're fortunate to have such a nice specimen here on campus. Thank you for joining me today on this exploration of evergreens here at the Scott Arboretum, and I hope you can join us sometime this winter on your next walk around, perhaps over the winter holidays, to enjoy all that the Arboretum has to offer. We are open dawn till dusk and 365 days a year, so come and enjoy.